Ah, thank you. This is great to be here. I'm looking forward to the story I'm going to tell you. With the introduction, what Ken told you about was my day job. What I'm going to tell you about now is kind of my night hobby. And as you'll see, the story I'm going to tell kind of blends quite nicely with the research I do for the Navy. For the Navy, I do high pressure and high oxygen. Here, I'm going to tell you about low pressure and low oxygen. So it's just a big continuum. I work at one end during the day, and, well, I work at the other as much as I can because I enjoy it. So I'm going to tell you about the story about how American physiologists learned to protect the health of the high-altitude warfighter in World War II. And so for those of you who don't know what physiology is, it's one of the pillars of medicine. It's a study of how the body functions in health and disease. If you're an aviation physiologist, you're working on problems that are unique to the adverse environment that aviation exposes the aviator to. So, and of course, from that comes aviation medicine. So we can look at the origins of aviation medicine. And really, we can go back to the late 1700s was when we began to learn about the biophysics of the atmosphere. We began to have an appreciation for things like barometric pressure and composition of the air. It was oxygen and mostly nitrogen. And we discovered what the partial pressure of oxygen was, which is really just taking into account the barometric pressure and the amount of oxygen that's in it. And this was coming out of some of the first balloon flights that were going on. As they continued with the balloon flights, they discovered that they might need to parachute if the balloon failed on them. And they actually, out of necessity, learned how to do parachutes, and the most simplest being that when the balloon would deflate, it would act as a big parachute bringing them down. But they did start to make jumps in the 1700s. Limitations on human physiology became more of a concern because they started to go higher and higher. And you reach a point where the oxygen gets so low that you begin to lose consciousness, you begin to have problems with the cold. So all these things were coming to the forefront then towards the late 1700s. And of course, the Wright brothers, you know, all we had were balloons until the Orville and Wilbur came up with the plane in 1903. And, of course, a few years later, we had airplanes in the first air war, 1916 to 1919. And sometime after that, they began to think, well, what about pressurizing the aircraft? Like today, when you fly commercially, most of these planes are pressurized. And they started doing it in balloon gondolas. They had a few planes before World War II, but the reality was pressure flight would not come into a common entity until after World War II. There was some, and we'll talk about that. So what I'm going to focus on tonight is that little blue arrow there. We're going to look at that 1939 to 1945 period. And it's a time when we had to go from losing our mental capacities and our physical abilities at altitude to having to remain alert while we're exposed to those conditions in unpressurized planes. Because if we didn't, we couldn't operate the mission, we couldn't fight the enemy, and we would have lost the air war. So this was a very important thing that had to happen. So a lot of problems had to be dealt with. Planes were flying higher than they'd ever flown before, and we had to deal with oxygen want or anoxia. We had to deal with the cold and the frostbite. We had to deal with decompression sickness, and I'll explain what all these are as we go on, but you can see there's a number of problems there, all of which could limit the warfighter's performance at altitude. So,
one of our planes was missing.
We're gonna kind of get into the mood of what the air war was like.
One of our planes was missing with all its gallant crew. The radio sets were humming. They waited for the word. Then a voice broke through the humming, and this is what they heard. Coming in on a wing and a prayer. Coming in on a wing and a prayer. Though there's one motor gone, we can still carry on. Coming in on a wing and a prayer. What a show, what a fight. Yes, we really hit our target weight. How we sing as we limp through the air. Look below, there's our field over there. With our full crew aboard and our trust in the Lord, we're coming in on a wing and a prayer.
So you could see that there was a lot of tough situations going on there. And so not only did you have people shooting at you and you're fearing for your life from that, but you also had to have your wits about you to deal with the fact that your oxygen lines might be freezing up. If you took your guns off to clear your jam gun, you might get frostbite. And so there were really two enemies you fought. There was the Axis forces we were fighting, but there was the unseen enemy of the high altitude environment. So before I get into the story, though, I'm often asked afterwards, how did I get interested in this? So I just thought I'd add a couple slides to show you this. And it's kind of an interesting story. It's all serendipity. And it happened both times in Ohio, and it happened during the early times of my career when I was training first as a graduate student at Ohio State. And about 1983, I moved into an office that had been occupied by this fellow, Fred Hitchcock, and he is a pioneer of pressurized flight research. What you can see here, starting left and coming down with the numbers, is the altitude chamber arriving in the spring of 1942 in Columbus, and then them setting it up. I'm not sure in that second picture if they popped the clutch on the truck and just rolled it down or what, but I don't think so. By the bottom picture, you can see they got some chains behind it, and then they were installing it in number five there. They ultimately had it into the lab, and then you can see they've got medical students, dental students, and conscientious objectors in there, and they're they're doing things to them, which we'll talk about later. But anyways, in Fred Hitchcock's office, I should mention he was a proponent of space flight. This is later after his retirement. He always wanted to go to the moon. He argued that the astronauts should be older men so that we don't, you know, if we lose people, we haven't lost a young man. He wanted to go to the moon, but obviously he didn't make it. Okay. The other thing that I found right here is what I call the Lost Hitchcock movie. And it wasn't Alfred, but it was Fred Hitchcock. And in this movie, I looked at this in the lab, and right away when it starts like this, that catches your eye. This is restricted. Experiments on explosive decompression. Well, at the time, I had no idea what that was. Explosive decompression is what happens if your plane loses pressure at altitude. And because of the high pressure in the plane, okay, here's a dog, he's going to decompress, boom, here he is. The air expands and cools, a fog forms, which you can see he survives. So they had very fundamental questions about, would you survive? Well, once they knew that the dog did, then they started putting the guys in there. Here's a guy explosively decompressing. And of course, you can imagine, I'm getting pretty interested in this movie. I don't understand it, but it looks really exciting. Well, this would be a major hook to get me snagged into pursuing this story for the next 30 plus years, believe it or not. Okay, the other thing that I found, Hitchcock was quite a photographer. And you can see he labeled his negatives, views inside the chamber, interior chamber with Bill, Abe, and Johnson moving the decompression chamber. So I would print up all these pictures. I'd spend evenings in the dark room, and it was just like it was exciting. It was exciting to see what these pictures were and then to try to figure out what the story was. The next thing that happened, though, was several years later, was when I finally finished my PhD and my postdoc training, I ended up at Wright State University in Dayton, Ohio. And that was significant because Dayton, Ohio has a lot to do with aviation, not just because of Orville and Wilbur, but because of the early days of aviation in the military. And during my 15 or 16 years that I was there, you can see if it's kind of a interesting situation geographically. Here's Wright State down here. This is my old lab off to the bottom right there. And then over here is Wright Field, and over here is Patterson Field, which today is Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, and right in between is Huffman Prairie. And that's the world's first airport. Huffman Prairie was where the Wright brothers made really the first practical airplane, and by that they mean, yeah, they flew little bunny hops at Kitty Hawk, but at Huffman Prairie they could take off, fly a route, come back and land where they took off from. So they had purposeful flight, okay? They could take off and land. And so you've got all this right there in that area. But what was great for me was that I discovered that if I went down to Wright-Patt Air Force Base, I could get access to the declassified aeromedical lab reports. And so it was not uncommon on a Friday afternoon noon for me to disappear for a few hours and to just totally immerse myself in these old reports. And so a lot of the images you'll see today come from those. Our story should start with this statement. This is F.G. Banting. He was a Nobel laureate. He was one of the co-discoverers of insulin, a Canadian. And because he was the top physiologist in Canada, by default, he became the head of aviation medicine when the war started for the Royal Canadian Air Force. And in early 1940s, actually towards the end of 1939, he has a quote here, which really was the belief of what the Allies thought, and it would drive much of the research during the war. And that is, whichever power gets up to 40,000 feet first and stays there the longest with the heaviest guns will win the war. And he went on to say, the greatest problem that faces aviation medical research today is that of high altitude flying. And it's our goal to provide an efficient pilot flying at 40,000 feet in safety and comfort and with the chance of security. Again, this is without pressurized planes. Recognize that today, most commercial airliners don't go to 40,000 feet. They usually do 35, 38,000. So this was quite the goal, but they thought that this would give them the operational advantage. And so, you know, reasons to fly high, well, we can see that it definitely gets you above the weather. We can also see that there's less resistance because the air is less dense up there, so you can fly farther and you can fly faster. It's hard for the enemy to engage you. They have to accelerate and be climbing to catch you at the high altitude. It's hard for forces on the ground, enemy forces, to see you and shoot at you because they can't hear you, or they can hear you, but they can't see you. And early in the war, the guns did not shoot that high. That changed over the course of the war. And of course, you had the combat advantage if you could dive on your opponent. And so there were a lot of reasons. For those reasons, they thought that 40,000 foot goal was what they wanted to do. Well, the reality was, and we got into the war after the Royal Air Force and the Royal Canadian Air Force and Australian Air Force. And so we benefited from watching what was going on with the various air forces of the United Kingdom. And early on, we sent one of the early designs of the B-17 Flying Fortress bomber over to England for them to use. And they were excited to get this, but they were having problems with it because what they were doing was that they were pushing them up higher than what they had been built to operate at. And you can see a quote here, 30,000 feet isn't enough for the bomber going on the raid because it's going to be intercepted by present-day fighters. It would have been the German fighters. The goal is 35,000 feet or higher, but when they started doing that, they found that in just about every mission, tactical operation at the top altitude sought suffered because of reduced capability of the flight crews. So what their problems they were having was that they were having, you know, the oxygen equipment couldn't function well at those altitudes because of the cold. They were having frostbite issues. They were having problems with decompression sickness in the aviators. So really, the Americans, in this case, Dr. John Fulton, he was the chairman of physiology at Yale, and he was on a member of the Committee on Aviation Medicine. He said, you know, this is really a physiological war. The air war has become a physiological war because the limiting factor is no longer the plane, but the pilot's ability to withstand the conditions that the plane is exposing them to. And so you can see here that I am built for speed, stress, and changes in temperature and pressure, says the plane. And the poor little pilot says, but I'm not built for any of those. And of course, his dog says, you must learn to protect yourself. So this is a story that I'll be sharing with you tonight. But to recognize what a challenge this was, let's just kind of look at what was, you know, how high did we go before World War II? And the little red dotted line down there is about 15,000 feet. That was actually a very high altitude in the pre-World War II era. Most planes went to about 10 to 12,000 feet. They went to 15,000 feet if they had to get over some mountains, but the people on board didn't fare too well because of lack of oxygen. And so that's before World War II. Now, on a few occasions, the aeronaut and the explorer had ascended quite high in balloons, and of course, that's where we'd begun to learn about the dangers of exposure at high altitude. And so these are just commemorating some of the balloon flights and how high they got. Once they started to use a sealed balloon gondola, which they would trap air in at ground level and then have a source of oxygen and CO2 absorber in there, they could take sea level pressure up with them, but they could go to very high altitudes like they did with Explorer 2, going to just over 72,000 feet. Okay, this was in the mid-1930s that the U.S. Army did this. So, and also on a few occasions, test pilots at various countries had flown to 43,000 and 54,000 feet in biplanes with open cockpits wearing all sorts of leather and fleece and breathing oxygen through a tube. And these planes could get up there because they had superchargers in them. They were able to compress the air and give enough oxygen to the engine for the fuel to burn. But the point is, this was the exception. This was not what most people did. All right? It was just a few handful of people had done this. And so now, in World War II, we were expecting to have an air war that was going to go up to 40,000 feet. And it wasn't just going to be a handful of select test pilots and explorers. It was going to be thousands and thousands of young men. So the question became, how do we keep a man alive at 35,000 feet? And it really wasn't just a man. How do you keep tens of thousands of men alive? And so if you look here, this is a B-17 bomber. It's got a crew of 10. Recognize that by the latter half of the war, they were, 10 men per bomber. They might send out 1,000 bombers at a time, 10,000 men right there, plus hundreds of fighter escorts. So you're having to sustain thousands of men in an environment where if they didn't have their oxygen and if their skin's exposed to the air, they're going to freeze, get frostbite, and die from lack of oxygen. So we're talking quite a task here. So we can go back to Dayton, Ohio, and I mention this because this really was the hub of the wheel that was aviation medicine. If you think of Dayton as being the hub with the aeromedical lab there, then spokes were going out to various research centers, both in the military and in the universities. And some of the men who played important roles, I've circled Randy Lovelace here. This is Harry Armstrong, who was actually very important for rejuvenating aviation medicine in America back in the early 30s. F.G. Hawes from Duke, Farrell Gaggy was from the Pierce Foundation at Yale, and Lauren Carlson, I think, was from Iowa. What they did was they recruited men from all sorts of universities because we didn't have a lot of aviation physiologists. So they said, if you're a physiologist and you're interested in this, we need you. And so they would leave the field they're doing, start working in this field. So you had Wright Field Aeromedical Lab. You also had the School of Aviation Medicine in Randolph Field in San Antonio, Texas. And of course, you had the U.S. Naval Aviation Research Lab right here in Pensacola. These are pretty much the three main military centers for aeromedical research during the war. And just to give you an idea of what the research program was, while the Office of Scientific Research and Development nationally funded 37 research grants at 27 different universities over the course of the war. And so these are places like Ohio State and the Mayo Clinic and other places. It's the University of Cincinnati and many others. And you can see the size of the grants. Money was a lot different back then, but you've got about $579,000 for 37 grants, about $15,000 per grant. Those of us who do this for a living know that that wouldn't go very far today. The most expensive grant was at University of Pennsylvania, $90,000, and the least expensive one was at the Mayo Clinic for $1, and that's all that they said that they wanted to do research on behalf of the war effort. Okay, now I've been showing you some cartoons here, and I want to tell you where those are coming from. These are thought pictures, which were drawn by the artist here, Eric Sloan. Perhaps some of you might know who he is. He's a famous American. He's an artist of weather and clouds, but also Americana and woodworking tools and things like this. And he was brought in to draw these, what they called thought pictures, which was the best way that they could figure out how to teach very difficult concepts of physiology and physics of the atmosphere to young men from all walks of life, some with a high school education, some with some college behind them. They had to understand these relationships between barometric pressure and partial pressure of oxygen and acceleration and g-forces. And so they thought, we can do this with pictures. And it says the flyer understands what he's reading if there's a picture to go along with it. And of course, here's this, here I am, tisk tisk, this is all very unscientific. But it really wasn't. It worked very well. In fact, it worked so well that when the Germans started to capture and interrogate downed American pilots, and the German physiologists would come in and ask them about their physiology equipment, how they used it, and what they understood about it, they said it was much better knowledge of how the equipment worked and why they used it than what the Luftwaffe had. So it was a very effective teaching manual. Now, I show you this picture. If you've been to the National Space Museum at the Smithsonian, there's a big mural on the wall when you enter, and this was done by Eric Sloan. And so these are just very good cartoons, which you'll see throughout tonight's talk. So let's talk about the first problem, and that has to do with decreased barometric pressure, and as a consequence, decreased oxygen pressure. And so I can tell you that we live in a sea of gas. Right here in Florida, we're pretty much at the bottom of that sea of gas. And that sea is the atmosphere that's pushing on us, okay? It's 21% oxygen and about 79% nitrogen. And so what happens is, if you say, what's the pressure of that gas? It's very high down here because, see, air is like a fluid. It has weight and exerts a force. If we ascend up in altitude, or in this case up this silo of water, the pressure is going to be less the higher up you go. Same thing with the air pressure, okay? Also, what's going to happen is the 21% oxygen that's in there is going to become 21% of a smaller and smaller total because there's less air pressure, okay? So that's why when you get to 10,000 feet, you better slap on your oxygen mask because you're going to need it. The rule of thumb was about 10,000 feet up, you put your oxygen on for daylight flying. If you were doing night flying, you wore it from the ground up because it improved your night vision. You could see better. So now what happens? Here's one of the thought pictures describing what happens with hypoxia, or what they call anoxia, at altitude. And so we're looking down here, these little teardrops are blood. You think of that as blood cells, and the amount of white on it's the amount of oxygen. And so at sea level, you're acting you're fine, you're normal, have good judgment, and your blood is about 90%, 95% saturated, the hemoglobin is, with oxygen. If I get up to 11,000 feet, I begin to have poor judgment, and I'm not quite aware what's going on. I start to act like I've had a few drinks too many. And you can see we're getting less and less oxygen here. We're now about 85% saturated. Okay, and now if I go up to 13,000 feet without oxygen, you can see I'm only 80% saturated. Now I'm having problems recalling things, which could be a problem, you know, it's going to be problematic if you're trying to remember how to operate your gun. And then at 18,000 feet, you can see you're going to lose consciousness. And of course, if you don't get your mask slapped on you or your problem fixed, you're going to eventually die. And just to show you that these cartoons were pretty accurate, here's a Navy cadet in the altitude chamber, and you see the pictures at 12,000 feet, 16,000 feet, 20,000 feet, and 25,000 feet. Okay. What makes this so bad is that he does not realize this is happening to him. Hopefully his colleagues flying with him will recognize it and can help him. But you yourself, if you're by yourself, you don't know what's happening and you're in big trouble. Okay, so as a consequence, it became very important to start have a good training program, which again, we didn't before the war. We didn't have a strong research program, we didn't have a good training program, but that changed quickly. And so, for instance, here in Pensacola, you can see here's the chamber that was at the Navy base, at the Navy Air Station. I love the picture on the right, what they're doing. You can see none of them have got their masks on, but the instructor does. And he's having them hold their hands out there so they can see themselves start shaking and also see their fingernails begin to turn purple, okay, as they lose oxygen in their blood. Of course, eventually they put their masks on, hopefully. But it wasn't just the Navy, the Army Air Force also had tons and tons of these chambers. This is just showing you a few of them around the country. And in fact, the program grew that we went from not having a training program that by 1945, the last year of the war, we had over 200 aviation physiologists who had been trained in San Antonio and Randolph Field. And this is just in the Army Air Force to run these altitude chamber programs. We had 65 altitude indoctrination chambers at 45 Army airfields, and over 58,000 men a month were being flying, if you will, in these chambers, learning how to use their oxygen equipment, how to recognize the effects of hypoxia. So it became just a huge program in terms of training these guys how to be safe at altitude. So let's talk about oxygen. When the war started, actually before the war, we didn't have a good mask. And yet, you could see you needed to have it because at altitude, without it, you're in trouble. And so if we look at the in-between World War I and World War II, what you had was a pipe stem. You would stick the tube in your mouth and you'd kind of smoke your oxygen, all right? They would have these on planes and you just kind of suck on it as you need it. Hopefully you weren't breathing through your nose too much. And 1938, at the Mayo Clinic, Dr. Boothby, Lovelace, and Bobolian came up with the mask shown here, which is called the BLB mask for Boothby, Lovelace, and Bobolian. And this was a big deal. They worked with, I believe it was Northwest Airlines, And this was a continuous flow mask. Oxygen would flow continuously into the bag, and you would rebreathe it through your nose back and forth. So it wasted a lot of oxygen because it was always flowing. But for the first time, they could fly at 20,000 feet, and they flew from Minneapolis to Los Angeles, stopping along the way, and it made national news. It was such a big deal that they could do this. So this is 1938. Here they are stopping. This is Randy Lovelace. You'll be hearing about him a lot. He would eventually become the director of the aeromedical lab at Wright Field for the U.S. Army Air Force. Here he is during flight doing blood gas analysis, looking at the oxygen levels in the blood that they're taking from each other's arms to make sure they're staying oxygenated. And here they are getting the Collier Trophy from President Roosevelt. Boothby and Lovelace were there, and Harry Armstrong was there from Wright Field because 1939 was the first year that there had not been any fatalities in commercial aviation due to lack of oxygen or fatigue in pilots. And so they said the research done by Armstrong at Wright Field and Boothby and Lovelace at the Mayo Aeromedical Unit was critical in that success. So they got the Collier Trophy for that. Of course, though, you can recognize that if you start breathing through your mouth with that mask because you get excited, you're still going to suck in low oxygen air and probably pass out. So, I'm ahead of myself. So this is just showing them using their BLB mask to go to 40,000 feet in the altitude chamber. Okay, so they wanted to close off that mouth, so they came up with an oral nasal version, 1941, and this actually became the first mask that the military was, well, actually they used the BLB also, but really the 1941. If you watch the movie Memphis Belle, you'll see them wearing these masks, okay, as they're flying up there, the pilot and the co-pilot. And just a little side story, it's interesting. Churchill, Prime Minister Churchill, always had the cigar, right? So you can kind of guess which mask he preferred on his transatlantic flights. And I don't have a picture of him, but you can see what it might look like would be like this. I don't know I recommend breathing pure oxygen and smoking at the same time, but Churchill referred to the oral nasal mask as a damnable muzzle. And so he preferred the BLB version. Now, they came up with, then, in 1943, a demand oxygen mask, and this was unique in that it had a valve in it, so it didn't waste oxygen, so oxygen was only admitted to the mask during inspiration. When you would inhale and drop the pressure inside, the valve would pop open, you'd get your oxygen. When you'd exhale, the valve would close, so it was much more efficient. This became a very popular mask. The final mask is the pressure mask, and this is like a little hyperbaric chamber on your face, okay? The mask, the demand mask in 1943, it was only good to about 35,000 feet because what happens once you get above 35,000 feet, the barometric pressure drops so much that even 100% oxygen isn't enough to sustain you. And so what they don't tell you when you fly commercially, you know, and they say in the unlikely event of loss of cabin pressure, put your mask on first before helping your child. Well, they don't also tell you the plane's probably going to do a steep dive because at 38,000 feet, you're still not going to get enough oxygen with 100%. So you got to get to a lower altitude. The pressure breathing mask, however, would raise the pressure in the mask, and so it would raise the pressure of oxygen. And so with this pressure breathing mask, it reversed the dynamics of breathing. The air blew in actively, and then you have to exhale against it rather than normally we passively exhale. But what it let them do was to get up to very high altitudes in a plane that was not pressurized. And this became very important in planes like the reconnaissance planes that didn't have guns. They could escape the enemy by scooting up to 42,000 feet or 40,000 feet just fine. So you can see with the water pressure in the mask, you could go up to 41, 43, and 47,000 feet. So with this mask, you could get to a higher altitude. This is just an interesting picture showing the prototype of the pressure breathing mask. Here's Randy Lovelace. These are two test pilots from Boeing flight test unit. And they were able to go to just under 43,000 feet for more than 2 hours, exercise, and they felt fine. This is, I got this from Randy Lovelace's daughter. If any of you know what a short snorter is, it's a dollar bill that you write. The people who are involved in a particular flight or mission will write on it, and then you carry it. And if someone asks if you can see your short snorter, and if you don't, if you can't produce it, you gotta buy them a short snort or a drink, okay? hence the name short snorter. But what you notice in this one is that this is the couple days after this flight, and here we are, the 40,000 footer, Loveless. Alan Reed's name is right here. Down here is James Frazier, and I think these were the folks who were test pilots from Lockheed. Here's Milo Burcham, Joe Toll, all there to talk about high altitude flight and how to do it. So this was a big deal. Incidentally, a B-17 did set an altitude record a little bit higher than this. They would go to just under 44,000 feet in July of 45, again using their pressure breathing mask to sustain their O2 levels. And with the pressure breathing equipment, you can see here that in the reconnaissance units, they did not have guns in here, they had cameras, so the only way they could protect themselves was to outrun the enemy, and they were able to get up to 40,000 feet just fine with their P-38 Lightnings using these masks. Okay, another problem. So you got low pressure, you got low oxygen, you got cold. And how cold was it? Well, if you're on a B-17 crew and you're flying in the European theater of operations in the last year of the war, you might fly on average at 25,000 feet. Your maximum altitude might be about 30,000 feet, and you might do this 35 times. And in the cold, January months, you can see 23,000 feet is minus 36 degrees Fahrenheit, and down to minus 61 degrees at 30,000 feet. And then, of course, in the summertime, it warmed up quite a bit. It was only minus 13 Fahrenheit and minus 40. So it was cold. And in these, they eventually figured out they could put a plexiglass shield over the open gun ports here, but still, it was pretty darn cold inside those planes. So not surprisingly, frostbite was a major problem. And you can see here in the 8th Air Force in 1942 in November when they started flying missions out of England over Nazi-occupied Europe, you can see there was a high incidence of frostbite over these first few months. It decreased, but there was always a problem that they had to deal with. And this is just showing you, this is what happens in your mask if you are not paying attention and you're exhaling your warmed, humidified breath with each breath. And it begins to frost up, and frost becomes ice, and pretty soon ice plugs your oxygen line, and next thing you know, you're lying on the ground. So this is a mask put on a breathing head in an altitude chamber at like minus 20 degrees and left to breathe for a while. This is what happens if you don't squeeze it and break the ice up. Now, don't worry, I'll enlarge what's necessary here. The point is, this is page one of a large report. And it's giving you examples of why missions were aborted in the 8th Air Force simply due to problems with oxygen and the electrically heated flying suits. And so if we pick a couple of these missions, you can see January 27th, 91 bombers went out and a third of them returned for various reasons, some of which included oxygen hose in the ball turret broke, oxygen regulators froze in the tail gunner and the left waist gunner. So where are these? Well, here's your ball turret guy here on the bottom. Here's your tail gunner at the back, and here's your waist gunner right there. So the point was, if the oxygen equipment didn't work, and if they weren't warm, or if I should say they were never really warm, if they weren't freezing, then the mission just didn't happen. Here's the worst scenario. On February 2nd, 83 planes went out, and they all returned. Obviously, a brutally cold day. Okay, so they're cold, they lack oxygen, if they or could potentially lack oxygen. The low pressure causes other problems. When we started ascending to altitude quickly in altitude chambers and in the new fancy planes that were being made in the late 30s, we realized that just like the divers who ascend too quickly, who have been breathing air, can get the bends from the drop in pressure causing nitrogen in the bodies mostly, but also other gases to bubble. Guess what? You go from sea level, a relatively high pressure, to high altitude, a low pressure, you're gonna have the same problem. And so divers have no priority on the bends. It was also a problem of the aviators. Okay, and so they began to realize this when, again, Harry Armstrong, the fellow who did so much to regenerate aviation medicine in America, in the early to mid-30s, he observed symptoms in himself that resembled the bends. And that's where he hypothesized that perhaps this is due to nitrogen bubbles forming. He observed bubbles forming in animals. You can see the bubbles here in the vasculature in the brain. And you can see the animal, the goat here, that wearing his oxygen mask, being subjected to a rapid decompression. And when they took that gas and analyzed it, you could see the largest component was nitrogen, which is an inert gas. You know, any gas will make bubbles if you expose it to low pressure. You know, you shake your pop bottle and open it and bubbles form. That's what's happening there. You're going from the high pressurized inside the bottle to low pressure in the air around it. The thing that makes nitrogen so bad is, first of all, it's 80%. That's what we're all equilibrated with right now, about 79-80%. But the body doesn't consume it. So once it's in your tissues, it's just there. It sits until a lower pressure around you allows it to come off as a bubble. Okay? And so Harry got the idea, and also with the folks at the Mayo Clinic, that what if we denitrogenate ourselves? What if we try to get rid of that nitrogen that's normally in our bodies all the time? How do you do that? Well, let's breathe 0% nitrogen. Another way to say that is let's breathe 100% oxygen. So breathing 100% oxygen and walking on a treadmill to get your blood flowing, you're going to begin to transport nitrogen to your lungs and blow it off in your breath, okay? And you're going to begin to, over a half hour or so, bring that nitrogen out of your body. So now when you pop up to 40,000 feet in your altitude chamber, you don't get the bends, okay? And it worked. They were able to do that in the altitude chamber just fine. So they said, well, let's actually try it in a flight. So they got Milo Burcham. Here you can see his signature on the snorter. Here he is riding a bike, exercising, breathing pure oxygen, making sure he's not breathing through his mouth, unloading nitrogen for about a half hour, got his mouth closed, and he was able to fly the P-38 up to 35,000 feet for quite a while and did not suffer decompression sickness or the bends or air embolism. They're all same name for different names for the same thing. So it worked. It was proof of concept. So they said, well, let's start having all the guys on the bomber crews and in fighters pre-breathe oxygen. And this is a graph showing that the longer you pre-breathe pure oxygen at ground level, the protection against getting bends is going to improve more and more and more. And so you tend to, by denitrogenating with lots of oxygen while you're at low altitude, at high altitude, you're less likely to get the decompression sickness. So air embolism was such a problem that the aeromedical lab actually named their research plane the nemesis of air embolism. And, okay, I got a song here. Here we go. Thank you.
Of a plane is a curious thing.
This is the U.S. Air Force band today.
I'm talking about those endearments painted with such sincereness on planes. Those glorious nicknames that held great meaning for its crew, its spirit, its fame. The nemesis of aeroembolism. Oh, the name of a plane is a curious thing. A curious thing is a name of a plane. Oh, the name of a plane is...
The nose art's interesting. You have the medical caduceus wrapped around a bathing beauty. And then the little guys off to the side, these are straddle gremlins, which supposedly caused all their problems at altitude, both mechanical and medical. And every time they pop up over 40,000 feet, they would paint another one of these along the side. Later in the war, they had a whole host of them here. So, okay, so they thought, if we don't pressurize the planes yet, what if we had a pressure suit? What if we could protect the pilot then from air embolism and hypoxia by encasing him in a suit that we could pressurize and take ground pressure up with us to altitude? You can actually see these had been, you know, fantasized a bit in the early and pre-war eras. And when they actually tried to build one, it looked kind of like what the cartoons are showing you there. But the problem was you could not move very well in them. I think this is a guy bent over a mock-up of a bomb site in a B-24. And so they didn't have good mobility. So they said, well, let's continue trying to pressurize the airplane so that we can eliminate some of these problems. And so they'd actually tried very early on back in 1920 at McCook Field, which was the first military airfield in Dayton. Lieutenant Harold Harris, who incidentally was the first man to ever jump from a plane out of necessity with a parachute to save himself, But he also had the distinction of flying the first pressurized plane, which was a de Havilland, and they put a steel tank in there, and they ran cables through these bladders, and thinking that they were going to leak a lot, there was a supercharger on the wing that would compress air and blow it into the tank. And the problem was he didn't have real good control. He just had one way to bleed it, but not much control over it. And so the in was faster than the out. So he said as soon as he got to 3,000 feet and closed the door and the thing started to pressurize, he knew he was in trouble because the altimeter read 3,000 feet, but the cabin pressure was equivalent to 7,000 feet below sea level. So the pressure was like he dug a hole 7,000 feet down. And, of course, the compressed air got very hot, and he had it on sneakers. He couldn't break the window. There was no hammer. So he was kind of worried, but he got it landed, and he parked it, got out, and he never flew it again. They would develop the air corps, though, would continue, and then again in the mid-30s, Harry Armstrong would work on the physiologic requirements of what would they test in what's known as the XC-35. His plane, as I understand, is in storage at the Udvar Hazy Museum, the Smithsonian at Dulles Airport. But this was a big deal that they were able to fly pressurized at altitude without using an oxygen mask. Ultimately, though, we would have a mass-produced pressurized bomber, a long-range heavy bomber, by April of 1944. And what you could see here, our bulkheads that resided about here and about here, and you could see they look almost like pressure chambers. And here's the crew tunnel that would stretch over the bomb bay, the diameter of which was determined by the fattest engineer they had at Boeing. And this was a big deal because you can see they can go to 30,000 feet and above without oxygen masks. But of course, the concern was what happens if you lose cabin pressure at altitude. And so about 6.5 pounds per square inch inside, and they didn't know would you survive. How big of a pressure gradient should we use, cabin relative to the atmosphere? Would there be gas-filled organs that would expand and I'd get trauma to them? Was there injury due to the wind blast as the air shot out of the plane at 150 miles an hour? Did I have time to put on my oxygen mask before I passed out? Would I get aeromedical? Would I get decompression sickness quicker? Would I fizz like a bottle of Coke? And so they started studying these things, and the first question was, how long would I stay conscious? And so initially they took the big altitude chamber and then put this little tube inside, and the poor guy would crawl inside. This would be the pressure cabin, and then they'd evacuate this to very high altitude. He'd be about a 10,000 foot equivalent in here. Then they'd knock the end off and they'd be at different altitudes. He'd crawl out and then they'd time how long before he passed out and fell over on the floor. So you can see that the higher the altitude you're at when decompression occurs, the less time you have to stay conscious. So this is why, you know, 35, 40,000 feet, this is why you put your mask on first before you do your companion. Okay. So then they said, well, let's take that pressure suit. We'll make that the pressure cabin. And what they did was they put a little diaphragm in the back, and he was pressurized in here, but at a high altitude, and then his buddy would stick a screwdriver in that and rupture it, and he'd explosively decompressed, and he survived. They took x-rays. They didn't see any damage to the lung. They said he had some gas pains, but he survived. So then they got a little bit better, and they took a cockpit of a P-38 fighter and use that as a pressure cabin, and they would seal it off, trapping pressure in here, and then put a paper flange over this, take this to a higher altitude, and then pop that open, and with different size orifices there, they could look at the rate of decompression and with different pressure differentials. And this is how they actually came up with the 6.5 PSI that they use now in the large planes. This is probably the most complicated picture I'll show you. But what they found out was if you have a small volume that you're going to, so say, let me say this a little different. If you could withstand a slow decompression better than a fast one in terms of how much expansion of gases occurs. If it's a slower decompression, you could withstand a fourfold increase in gas volume. If it's a fast decompression, you can only withstand a twofold increase before tissue starts to be damaged in the body. So for this reason, they said, well, let's use for the big planes a large pressure because you know, blow the whole nose off, they're still going to take several seconds to decompress. Whereas with a fighter, with that big canopy on it, it can decompress very fast. So we'll just put a little pressure on there to give them protection, but we don't want them to have barrel trauma if they decompress too fast. As far as I know, those are pretty much still the same pressure differentials they use today. Now, down the road at Ohio State, they began to study the physiology of explosive decompression. So this is going back to Fred Hitchcock and the fellow that got me interested in all this. And here you can see they were in the War Research Building, and here they are. And they initially did animal studies. And what you could see is as this anesthetized rabbit decompresses, the gas pressure around him drops that his lungs begin to empty. And you can see the humidified breath coming out, and you'll notice the fog forms. You can see how much the gases inside expanded during decompression compared to before. Inside, as those gases expand, we get an inhibition of blood return back to the heart, so you see pressure drop during the explosive decompression. And that expansion of the lungs causes fluid to go up into the head, and it causes a pressure spike, and there was actually some microhemorrhages in the brain of these animals. So it does some things. We're going to just take a couple of minutes here and look at what's going on with explosive decompression. So here they're at anywhere from ground level to about 10 or 20,000 foot equivalent, which is supposedly the aircraft, and then they're going to rapidly decompress. Now watch this guy's chest come popping out at you. See that? As you drop the pressure around him, the lung chest wall dynamics change, and you actually expand out this way. You see that? They have no control over that. That's just the pressure dropping around them. And so what they're going to do now is they're going to stay at altitude, and they wanted to know if they would survive, would they have a higher incidence of decompression sickness. So they're going to go into the chamber, they're going to exercise. I won't show you the whole movie in the essence of time, but interest of time, but what they found was that if you were sitting perfectly still, which you usually didn't do if you're in the middle of a battle, but if you're sitting perfectly still, yes, you did get a higher incidence of decompression sickness. However, as soon as you started to exercise, move around like you would, moving, you know, ammo and running around in the plane, that masked any difference that you had between a slow and a rapid decompression. So that was good news. They could survive it. This is them doing their exercise at 38,000 feet. Okay. Okay, but so let's look at the B-29 here. These things did explosively decompress, and you see when they did, quite often a guy would go shooting out the window. And they finally got smart and started using a harness here to hold them. And so just to show you what this is like, this is 6.5 PSI. And you'll notice this is the post-war period, and they're wondering, well, how big do we make the windows? You can see they're pretty big here. You don't want to make them big for that reason, okay? Of course, if you're really sadistic, here it is in slow motion. Ooh, yeah. Okay. So just an interesting story. When they were getting ready to deploy the B-29s into the China-Burma-India theater of operations, a pressurized Constellation came into Wright Field, and here's Loveless and Gaggy and Henry Sweeney, he was the one that was doing the studies I was showing you earlier with the pressure suits. And they decided they would do a controlled decompression with a full passenger load. And they were going to give everybody a questionnaire to fill out. And, you know, the plan was to fly to the indicated altitude. And then at the right time, Sweeney would break open this diaphragm and the plane would rapidly decompress. And everybody would put on their oxygen mask and then they would slowly descend. And everybody would fill out the questionnaire about what it felt to experience this decompression. And so they had 50 people on board. They were at 20,000 feet. The pilots wore demand oxygen masks continually, and on decompression, they were to descend 1,000 feet per minute down to 10,000 feet. So that was the plan. So the great moment came. The pilots were alerted, and Sweeney, well strapped to his seat, slashed the paper diaphragm with a knife. You can see he's actually got a shoulder harness here holding him in. And here's the pressure. They went from an 8,500 foot equivalent to 20,000 feet. And the problem was that no one had told the pilots that when the air expanded and cooled, it would form a fog. Well, they thought the fog that formed was a fire. And so they got kind of worried when the entire cabin completely fogged. So they put the plane, thinking it was on fire, into a dive from 20,000 to 3,000 feet in less than a minute. And no one got their masks on. No one filled out the questionnaire. They were all hollering and yelling. And so much for their controlled decompression. No one was hurt. Okay. Okay, two more topics and we'll be done here. High altitude bailout. Problems here are you got to worry about anoxia, and you also have to worry about the parachute opening shock. And here you can see they have an oxygen bottle they're taking with them. And here's what happens if you decelerate too quickly with your parachute. So Randy Lovelace, the director of the aeromedical lab, wanted to experience this for himself. So he'd never jumped before, so he decided to do a jump from 40,200 feet. Nothing like, going for the whole Monty there, the full Monty, I guess. So here they are with here he is with the Boeing test pilots, pre-breathing oxygen so they don't get the bends. They're going to hop into their nemesis of air embolism and take off. And here he is with his oxygen bottles strapped to his leg, pre-breathing oxygen. And there he is standing on the bomb bay, getting ready to go. His comment was, it looks like a hell of a long way down there. And he's hooked up with a static line. He plummets through the bomb bay, and they're following him down. There's a chase plane plus the B-17, and they think he's dead because he's laying limp in the parachute, and the parachute's oscillating back and forth like this in almost 90 degrees each way. And they finally saw a feeble gesture at about 8,000 feet. When he landed, he was in shock. What had happened was the opening shock, which they would later calculate to be 33 Gs, had knocked both gloves off of his left hand. He got frostbite on his hand. They gave him the Distinguished Flying Cross, but then he said, you know, we better figure out how to do a high altitude jump. And so they studied it at Wright Field, and they got this group of guys together, and they had hard rubber dummies and a St. Bernard dog weighing 145 pounds. Now, here's the dummy. Here's the device tensiometer that measured the opening shock. Here's the tear you can see from one of the opening shocks. And then they wanted to make sure the data collected with the dummies would extrapolate to a living animal. So they didn't want to jump, so they went to the Dayton Dog Pound and bought Major for $3, fattened him up from 120 to 145 pounds, and he became a parapooch for the U.S. Army Air Force. Now, the device that they used is a tensiometer, the Lindquist-Ryan tensiometer, and there was a number of springs here, which there was a stylus that would be pulled down when the chute opened. A film would scroll across here, and it would scratch on the film, so you got a time and force displacement. This was actually, Ryan would take this device and would eventually become the black box data recorder over several years. This is kind of the start of that. And so here we are in the B-17. Here's our dummy. Here's a neck hole, shoulder. Here's a tensiometer. Here's a chute. Here's another one. So what they do is they get six of these, and they would pull the strings and get the clock mechanism going so the film would run, and then they'd drop them on static lines, and the tensiometers then would record what the opening shock was as a function of parachute, canopy size, altitude, and plane speed. And so the red arrow there is showing you where the opening shock is greatest. And of course, six of these, you can see them coming down here at high altitude. So they did a bunch of these jumps. Here's an example. Over a half a second, you could see a force of about 25 Gs if you open your chute immediately at 26,000 feet. And so what came out of all this was that they learned that if you waited before you opened your chute and were at a lower altitude, you actually had less of an opening shock. So you see at 40,000 feet, it's 33 Gs of deceleration. And at 3,000 feet, you got about 12,000. So this is where they started, and what happens here is that you actually slow down as you free fall into denser air, and your terminal velocity is much less than what it is when you first leave the plane. You're initially going the plane speed with its forward momentum. So this is what they taught them with their thought picture. Bailing out at high altitude, I'm still going nearly 250 miles per hour. Just wait and slow up before pulling the cord. Okay, wait. Okay, wait some more. Keep your fists clutched so your gloves don't blow off like they did for Lovelace. and now open your chute. So this is really how they came up with the practice of using a delayed parachute opening. Now, just a little bit about Major, because people are always interested in this. Here you can see Major being cajoled to put on his parachute again. And you can see he's wearing the colors of the aeromedical lab. And so here he goes. This is actually taken from when he did his second jump at 26,000 feet. The movie is, I got to go up in a B-17, so I just put that in there so you can see what's like. Yeah. So this is Major hanging in the bomb bay. This is the bomb bay doors. Here's his tensiometers. Here's his parachute. The bombardier would hit the buttons. The switches would release. Off he'd go on his static line. And, of course, another four-point landing. So I had a chance to talk to Ken Penrod's son, and he said, Dad told us about Major. And he said the thing about Major was that he would dog paddle all the way down. He would run in place the whole time he was drifting down. But he also said that Major got less and less enthusiastic about the mission the more times they dropped him. So, something I always wondered was when you look at the data here, this is altitude, here's opening shock, G-forces, and Major went up to 26,000 feet, but they never took him to 33 and 40,000 feet, and yet they made him this nice flight suit and oxygen mask so they could do that. And I always wondered why he didn't go to the next step. Well, when I got the color slides from the Lindquist family, they were gracious enough to share them with me. Written on the slide, it says, Major, after 26,000 foot drop, harness ripped. And so the 15 Gs at that altitude darn near ripped him out of his harness, and they almost lost him. So I'm sure they thought, well, that's enough for the dog. We got enough data. We'll let him go. Here you can see the tensiometers here. They had a high gain and a low gain one. And but so he retired and dreamt of better days. But you see, he was advertised nationally. Major's blazing a trail for possible parapooch branch. Major willing subject of Army experiments at Muroc Air Base. I think that's not true. So then, before we get into the last topic, which is the G-suit and acceleration, I stumbled onto this report. This is another example of acceleration. The tensiometers were used here. This was a pilot pickup or the snatch pickup, where the idea was if you're stuck somewhere, they would drop you a packet that had these poles and a rope and a harness for you to sit in, and then the plane comes by and grabs you. And so off you go, and if you really want to see this, on YouTube, there is a video of this. All you got to do is look at personal pickup tests at Wright Field. I take about 3.5 minutes to reel them back into the plane. Fun thing to do, yeah. Okay, last topic, acceleration. So this has nothing to do with altitude, really. This is just due to the high performance of the planes. Planes like the Thunderbolt could dive at near the speed of sound. And as you're pulling out, the centrifugal forces all the blood down into your legs. It gets very hard for the heart to pump then the blood up to your eyes and to your brain. And so you begin to lose your vision. You begin to gray out. You black out, which means that you go blind. And then eventually you lose consciousness. And so they studied this using centrifuges. They studied it not only at the Male Aeromedical Unit, but also at Wright Field, up in Toronto at the Royal Canadian Air Force. I believe Australia had one too. It was quite a collaborative effort. This is Earl Wood, who I had the fortunate experience to meet before he passed away. This is Earl riding the centrifuge at Wright Field. And he is the one that came up with the M maneuver, which stands for male, which is the grunting and straining you see. It creates tremendous positive pressures to keep the blood from pooling. If you look at this, he's at 4 Gs here. And a little bit later, he's at 8 Gs? I guess 8 Gs he's pulling there. Earl lived to be in his mid-90s, so it didn't hurt him too much. Okay, what they came up with is shown here. Here's our G-suit in New Guinea. And of course, they started with this. They tried just wrapping the body. And then over about a year and a half time, they went through several generations of this a bladder arrangement over the legs and the calves and the abdomen, and came up, though, with a very effective suit that kept the blood from pooling in the lower extremities. And now, so if you were in Rochester, Minnesota at the Mayo Clinic, you looked up in the air, you'd see this plane flying around. It was the Gee Whiz. And this is what they used to field test the G-suit. They would put the G-suit on the pilot in the front, and then the physiologist would sit without one in the back, but he'd be instrumented so they could see what happened. You can see here they're doing a maneuver, pulling 5 Gs, and this is what it looks like. They put the oximeter on his ear. That's why he's got the little bonnet on his head. This is measuring saturation of blood with oxygen. And so here you go. You accelerate, and we're going to look at just ear pulse, so his heart beating, and the ear opacity, which is how much oxygen is in the blood. And you can see it over time. That drops. You can see that the pulse getting up to the ear is dropping. And so here he's alert, and now he's into the pulling the maneuver, and he starts to get a little groggy. And he's a little bit further into the maneuver. You can see he's almost losing consciousness. Now he's off in la-la land after the maneuver's over. And, of course, all during this time, he's vulnerable to being shot down by his adversary. So they came up with a G-suit, and what it could do is it could extend you by the white mount shown here. Normally, if clear vision was lost at 3 to 3 to 3.5 Gs, you could extend it to 5 and almost 6 Gs, okay? Visual dimming, you could extend it. So you could, what you could do now is outperform your adversary. You could turn sharper on them. You could beat them in a dogfight. And in fact, what they found out, wearing the G-suit, you were twice as productive in terms of number of aircraft shot down per 1,000 sorties. You can see it went from 16 to 29. Any way you looked at it, you doubled your productivity with the G-suit. Okay, so in closing, there should be some music here. Okay. So was World War II a 40,000-foot war? It was, but it was the exception rather than the rule. Most of the fighting was done at 20, 25, 30, 35,000 feet. We could get to 40,000 feet and above with reconnaissance planes and on some bombing missions, but it was the exception rather than the rule. But what happened was because we developed the equipment to function at 40,000 feet, we were ready in the post-war era when the jet age came. We had the equipment. We were able to go to those higher altitudes now with the pressurized cockpits and with the G-suits and pressure suits that came down the line. And so it was a good thing that happened. In fact, Randy Loveless, he said, if equal air power had existed in terms of airplanes and air crews, the contributions of the Army Air Force aeromedical research would have provided a margin of supremacy. So we know that by the end of the war, things weren't equal in terms of air power. We had won air supremacy, but the research had advanced to the point that it would have made the difference had things been equal. Here's Loveless. He would go on to be head of the Loveless Clinic in Albuquerque, which would play an important role in the selection of the initial Mercury 7 astronauts. Here's a picture of them that they've signed to him. He would also become the director of space medicine during the Gemini program. Here he is being sworn in on behalf of President Johnson. So, last slide. Then and now, well, you can see we got the pressure breathing masks. I don't think they've changed all that much. The G suits are, not that different from what they had back then. We still pre-breathe oxygen. We do it when we go on high altitude reconnaissance and spacewalks. In terms of high altitude bailout, we can't do much higher than what they did when the Red Bull jump occurred. But many of the same problems had to be overcome that Loveless did, and explosive decompression is still a threat. So thank you, and I'm glad to take some questions. Got one in the front row here.
You told us what the Americans or the Allied side did. Can you tell us what the enemy was doing at the same time?
You're right. So the Germans, I know more about them than I do the Japanese. The Germans actually had been working on this since the, just like they've been building up their military aircraft since the early 30s, they'd also been doing aviation medicine. So that going into World War II in 1939, they were considered the top aeromedical group in the world. And but what happened was that during the war, we and interestingly enough, a number of their scientists had trained in America, and they were colleagues with us. And but we lost all contact, obviously, during the war, so we didn't know what was going on during the war as much. And so we still thought that there was this, you know, superiority there possibly. Well, as it turns out, we actually excelled and were better than them in most areas. I mean, they did get the ejection seat first, and in terms of rockets and things like that. But overall, as I showed you there at the end with Lovelace's quote, we did get a better program and training program. They were doing a lot of the same things. We were in parallel. Their right field was in... it's escaping me. It's in Eastern Germany. And one of the head guys there was Hannes Benzinger. And he was essentially the Fred Hitchcock doing explosive decompression studies there. So they had an active program, and they had a number of training centers. In fact, Lovelace had toured Germany just before it started in 1939. He came back and met with Roosevelt's physician and had him talk to Roosevelt, saying, "We've got a problem because they've got 40 altitude chambers. We have three. You know, we need to hurry." So they had a program. They were very active, but of course it started to get bombed, and I think we exceeded them eventually. I know we did. Yeah.
One of your slides you showed, I think it was a second sequence during decompression, the person started laughing. Were there any studies neurophysiologically looking at what was going on in the brain to trigger that particular response?
No, not that I'm aware of. The neurological studies that were done at this time were pretty much, in terms of the animal experiments, they were fairly gross, just looking to see what if there was obvious changes, and, you know, by looking at the organ in an autopsy. In terms of humans, they didn't do any of that. It was just more or less, could you tolerate it? Could you get your mask on in time? So they didn't get too much into mechanisms like we would do it today.
I have one more question. There it went. Just as a point of interest, I've been involved in a couple of explosive decompressions in a small cockpit A4, a Navy A4 airplane. And my first indication of it was, and you didn't mention, was the face of my clock or my watch blowing off and hit me in the in the helmet. That happened before anything, and then the ears and everything else.
Right.
So that I knew the second time that it happened when I got hit.
Yeah, yeah.
In the face that I was having an explosion.
Well, you don't mess with pressure. You know, you get a big pressure gradient. You can inflate something and get a big pressure in it by dropping pressure around it, and that's what's happening to your watch.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.